Romans chapter number 10. Ask that you take your copy of God's word. Journey with me to Romans chapter 10. Look with me briefly at verses 16 through 21. I'd like to thank you for your patience through this series of Book of Romans. Trust that you've been blessed by the information that you have been provided with. Pray that your faith is being increased and that you're learning more and more about what God has done for us and what God expects from us. Romans chapter number 10, verses 16 through 21. Trust that everyone has it.
Word by God reads like this. However, they did not all heed the good news. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed our report? So faith comes from hearing, and hearing by the word of Christ. But I say, surely they have never heard, have they? Indeed, they have. Their voice has gone out into all the earth, and their words to the ends of the world. But I say, surely Israel did not know, did they? First, Moses says, I will make you jealous by that which is not a nation. By a nation without understanding will I anger you. And Isaiah is very bold and says, I was found by those who did not see. I became manifest to those who did not ask for me. But as for Israel, he says, all the day long I have stretched out my hands to a disobedient and obstinate people.
If I can hold your attention for just a moment, I want to bring from the subject, obeying the messenger's message. You may have your seats. Thank you very much, ushers. Obeying the messenger's message. Obeying the messenger's message. In Matthew chapter 19. Somewhere around verses 16 through 22. There we find Jesus having a brief conversation with whom the Bible defines as a rich young ruler. Matthew chapter 19, verses 16 through 22. A young man who has great possessions approached the Lord Jesus Christ to ask him how it was he could obtain eternal life. In response to the young man's question, Jesus responded by saying, in order to obtain everlasting life or eternal life, all you need to do is obey the commandments. Into which the rich young ruler responded by asking Jesus, which commandments am I required to obey in order to obtain eternal life? Jesus names a few. He says, in order to obtain eternal life, all you need to do is not murder anybody. In order to obtain eternal life, all you need to do is not steal from anybody. In order to obtain eternal life, all you need to do is not commit adultery. In order to obtain eternal life, all you need obtain eternal life, Jesus says, all you need to do is love your neighbor as yourself. Is there a Bible reader here this morning? And to which the young man responds to Jesus by saying, all of these things I have kept from my youth. What is it then that I am lacking that is keeping me from receiving eternal life? When the rich young ruler is determined to be perfect, Jesus says, if you would be perfect, then what you need to do in order to obtain eternal life is go and sell all of your possessions, give them to the poor, pick up a cross, and follow me.
The next statement is a very interesting statement. The Bible says the rich young ruler walked away from Jesus sorrowful. Unfortunately, ladies and gentlemen, we do not know whether or not this rich young ruler ever obeyed the instructions that Jesus provided to him, or whether or not he continued to walk away and be sad. But what we do know is that on the day the rich young ruler approached Jesus and asked him how he could receive eternal life, and Jesus preached to him the message of salvation, which is to pick up a cross and follow me, the rich young ruler did not accept his message because it would require him, hear me, to change his lifestyle. did you hear what I said? The rich young ruler had great possessions, the Bible says, and when Jesus tells him that in order to be my disciple, in order to have eternal life, it requires that you make a change in your life. And the rich young ruler walked away sad, not because he didn't like Jesus, he just didn't like the message. In a similar instance, ladies and gentlemen, I have discovered that there are many people who disobey the message of salvation because it requires us to change our lifestyle. In other words, ladies and gentlemen, there are many people who would love to spend eternity in the presence of God, but we just got a problem with letting go of our adultery. We would love to spend eternity in the presence of God, but we have a problem with taking stuff that don't belong to us. We would love to spend eternity with God, but to spend eternity with God would mean that we would have to let go of what we love. I stood up this morning to let you know that you cannot have your cake. Lifestyle and expect to stretch yourself up into heaven. You gotta let go of sin and pick up a cross and follow the Lord Jesus Christ.
I know what you're saying. I hear what you're saying, Brother Reverend Pastor Preacher. That I got to let go of my sinful lifestyle in order to have everlasting life. But why is it that I should obey the message of salvation? Why is it that I should sell all my possessions and give to the poor? Why is it that I should pick up a cross and follow Jesus? Why should I obey the message of salvation? Here in our selected text, the Holy Spirit makes known to us why it is that both you and I should obey the message of salvation. First, you should obey the message of salvation, hear me clearly, because the heavens proclaim salvation. If you graced us with your presence on last week, then you would have heard me preach a sermon I entitled Messengers of Salvation. And it was in that little sermon that the question was raised, why should you be a messenger of salvation? And if you took good notes, then you would have learned that you should be a messenger of salvation because God is depending on you. And not only should you be a messenger of salvation because God is depending on you, but you should be a messenger of salvation because God made you a messenger. And it was based on that argument that Paul eases his way into Romans chapter number 10, verse 16, by using the contrasting, connecting word, however. That is, ladies and gentlemen, despite the fact that God has made you and me a messenger of salvation, and despite the fact that God has made the generation before us messengers of salvation, and despite the fact that God has made the generation before us and the generation before them messengers of salvation, the fact of the matter is, everybody will not receive your message. I don't care how exegetical, theological, hermeneutical, or clear you can communicate the word of God. It does not matter how intelligent you are. Some people will just not accept what you have to say. I didn't make that up. It's in your Bible. Paul says, however, they all did not heed. The word they here in the text specifically refers to Israel. But it includes, but it is not limited to Israel as much as it includes everybody who rejects the message of salvation. Paul says, however, they did not heed the good news. Word heed here in the text literally means to obey the good news. It simply means to do what the good news says do. The assumption, ladies and gentlemen, is that the good news had been heard, it just had not been obeyed. The assumption is they heard good preaching. They heard good teaching, but they just refused to obey what they heard. And I'm convinced, ladies and gentlemen, that the same problem Paul faced in his day is the same problem that we as the church face in our day. It's not that people have not heard the good news. It's not that they don't understand the good news. We just got a problem with obeying. We heard that it's wrong to tell a lie, but we won't obey what we heard. We heard that it's wrong to mess with another man's wife, but we just keep on messing with her. We heard that it's wrong to do this, but we won't obey what we heard. Paul said they did not heed what they heard. Verify that Israel had heard the good news, the message of salvation. Paul quotes Isaiah chapter 53, verse 1, when Isaiah says, who has believed our report? Who has believed what we have told them? Word believe.
simply means to obey. It means to act on what you heard. It means to respond to what you heard. It means to commit yourself to what you heard. Again, the assumption is that the message had been heard, but they have not obeyed it because they did not believe it. Myself looking nice this morning, but y'all making me work mighty hard here. He said, in order to obey what you heard, it requires that you first believe what you heard. The assumption therein is this: if you are having a problem with obeying what you know, it's probably because you don't believe what you know. If you're having a problem with standing up for the Lord Jesus Christ, it's probably because you don't believe that He is the Lord Jesus Christ. If you're having a problem with trusting in God, it's probably because you don't believe that God will make a way somehow. If you're having a problem loving God, it's probably because you don't believe that God loves you. Paul says they did not heed it simply because they did not believe it. They didn't respond to it. They didn't obey it. They couldn't commit to it because they didn't believe it. Examine your life, ladies and gentlemen. Find out where you are having problems obeying God. And it's probably because you don't believe it. Can I help you with that?
Lord, I'm having witness there. Glad I'm going on.
Bible says no adulterers have entered the kingdom of heaven. That's what your Bible says. No adulterers have entered the kingdom of heaven. If we really believed that, then we wouldn't continue to commit adultery. But we continue to commit adultery because we don't believe it. Not because we have not heard it. We just simply do not believe it. Let me just be real with you right here. Yes, God is loving. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, God is kind. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, God is merciful. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, God is able to take your sins and cast them in the sea of forgiveness. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. But God is also a God of wrath who is waiting to pour out His wrath on all the children of disobedience. Cannot obey what you do not believe. Isaiah 53 verse 1, Isaiah says, who has believed our report? Who has believed our report? Some genius would say, well, maybe Israel did not hear the word of God. Maybe no one ever told them about the word of God. Paul says, faith comes by hearing. Hearing by the word of God. In order to feel the tension of the text there, requires that you understand what Paul means by hearing. Normally we associate hearing with the ear. But Paul's use of the word hearing specifies that of the eyes. In a real sense, Paul says that you can actually hear with your eyes. To validate Paul's statement that you can hear with your eyes, Paul quotes Psalm 19, verse number 4, when David says, the heavens proclaim His name.
Read Psalm 19, verse 1 through 7 when you get home, and you'll find it that David says, the heavens proclaim God, hear it, without making a sound. In other words, the assumption therein is that when you look up at the heavens, you have to know there is a God somewhere. When you look down at the greenness of grass, when you look down at the whiteness of snow, when you look how high the maple tree grows, when you see the clouds in the air, when you see the bird flying through the sky, you have to know there's a God somewhere. Paul said, don't tell me you ain't heard the gospel. If you woke up this morning and saw your reflection looking back at you, let you know there's a God somewhere. If you woke up and put your socks on your feet and your hat on your head, there's a God somewhere. Don't tell me you ain't heard the gospel. Don't tell me you haven't heard the gospel. If you can see, you heard the gospel. If you can walk, you heard.
I beseech you in the name of Jesus, be seated, please. David said in Psalm 19, verse 4, the heavens proclaim the gospel. In Psalm 19, verse 4, David specifically speaks about the sun. He talks about literally everywhere the sun shines is the proclamation of the gospel. Are you able to tell me a place where the sun doesn't shine? The assumption is this. If the sun shines everywhere, then the gospel has been proclaimed everywhere. But all of Israel, all of people have not believed what they heard. They simply have not believed what they heard. But you should obey the message of salvation because the heavens proclaim. Did you hear me? Not because you heard some preacher put a sermon together, but you should believe the gospel, if nothing else, because the heavens proclaim. The heavens proclaim that there is a God. But Israel had a double problem. Not only did they know that there was a God to be served, they had a law that they called the law of Moses, the Torah, or the Pentateuch, that told them how to serve him. Did you get that? Not only could they look up at the sky, the sun, the moon, and the stars and know that there was a God to be served, but God had given them a law on the mountain of Sinai that told them specifically how to serve. I'm looking at people that not only do you know that there's a God to serve, but you have in your hand what we call the B-I-B-L-E that gives you instructions on how to serve. Therefore, you don't have an excuse about why you don't obey the message of salvation, because if the heavens ain't told you enough about it, you got a Bible that can tell you everything that you want to know about. Simply have no excuse as to why you shouldn't obey the message of salvation. One thing that I like to do in my spare time is watch a show called Forensic Files. I love to sit back and watch how these scientists discover how people commit crimes. One particular episode of Forensic Files, there was a man who was married, but he had a mistress. And when his wife was about to find out about his mistress, he decided to kill his mistress. He killed
healed his mistress, and you can tell he was no expert in committing murder, because he left behind a trail of evidence that pointed directly to him. But despite all of the evidence that pointed directly to him, the case went unsolved for 20 years. But after the 20 years had passed and there was a new prosecutor and new detectives assigned to the department, and they opened the case again and they saw all of the evidence that pointed only to one person, the detective asked a very interesting question. He said, "I don't know what took them so long to recognize who committed this murder. With all of the evidence that points to that person, I don't understand what took them so long." Let me just go ahead and tell you what I'm talking about. I really don't understand that with all of the evidence that tells both you and I that there is a God, I don't know what takes us so long to commit ourselves to the gospel of salvation. With everything that tells us that there is a heaven to go and a hell to shower, what takes us so long to commit ourselves to the message of salvation? Salvation, because the heavens proclaim salvation. Here's what I've been trying to get to all morning. Not only should you obey the gospel of salvation because the heavens proclaim salvation, but you should obey the message of salvation because the heathens proclaim salvation. You know what a heathen is, don't you? Yeah. You and me. Yeah. You should obey the message of salvation because the heathens proclaim salvation. In verses 19, 20, and 21, Paul tells us something that should make everybody in here shout. Paul explains in verses 19, 20, and 21 how it is that the Gentiles, that is, how it is that both you and I became recipients of salvation. Paul says, verse 19, "But I say surely Israel did not know, did they?" Still speaking about salvation, Paul says they don't obey it because they couldn't have known it, could they? The assumption is if they knew better, they would do better. He said they didn't realize it, did they? They didn't comprehend the message, did they? They didn't understand the message, did they? I'm sure they couldn't have understood it. If they understood it, they wouldn't have done what they did. Did they? But Paul is not cutting anybody any slack this morning. Paul says, "Do you see it? Moses said." Moses said, "I will make you jealous by that which is not a nation. By a nation without understanding will I anger you." This is a quotation from Deuteronomy chapter 32. In Deuteronomy chapter number 32, God is upset with Israel. He is upset with Israel because they have chosen to run after other gods who had done absolutely nothing for them. God was upset with Israel because God had taken them out of the land of Egypt. He had opened up the Red Sea. He had opened of the Jordan River. He had allowed them to take possession of the land of Canaan. He had given them wells they did not dig, vineyards they did not plant, and they had the audacity to turn their back on God. But God told them, in the day that you choose not to serve me, then I will choose not to protect you. God told Israel, the only reason that your enemies are not able to destroy is because I'm keeping them back. The only reason that your vineyards are growing is because I'm allowing them to grow. But in the day that you choose not to serve me, I'm going to move my hand and see what will become of you. Here's why I almost want to say thank God for Israel. You'll find out for me in a minute. Because when Israel decided not to obey God, guess what God did? Your Bible's still open. I plan on preaching from it. He says, I will make you jealous. You know what it means to be jealous of. It literally means to covet. It simply means to want what somebody else has. Feel the tension of the text. God says, Israel, I gave you salvation. But if you don't want it, I'll take it from you, and I'll give it to them, and I'll make you want what you had, but you didn't want. I just got to say, that's why I take preaching so serious. Because God could choose anybody to preach his word, but the fact that God chose me, I give it all. But they refused to submit to God. So God said, I'm going to make you jealous by giving it to somebody who don't even know. For Paul said, I will make you jealous by that which is not a nation. By a nation without understanding will I make you jealous. And Isaiah is very bold, the text says. And the text says that Isaiah is very bold. It simply means that Isaiah spoke clearly. He spoke clearly when he said, I was found by those who did not seek me. I became manifest. I made myself known. Hear it to those who did not ask for me. God, I said the other Sunday, came chasing after us. We did not go chasing after God. God says they didn't ask for me. They were not trying to inquire about me. They were not searching for information about how to serve me. But I am going to give them everything that I gave you because you don't appreciate it. Thank God for Israel. I know it's a bad thing that they didn't obey God's word, but if they had obeyed God's word, then God wouldn't have took salvation and gave it to us. Thank God. Says they made me jealous by going after other gods. So I'm going to make them jealous by giving salvation to people who do not know me. Thus, the heathens proclaim salvation. We proclaim salvation now because God has had mercy on us who did not ask for God's mercy, but he gave it to us anyway.
You were looking for a place to shout, you just missed it.
But if you were waiting for your part of the sermon, there was, and it just passed you right by. So let's rewind and hit play one more time. God gave us salvation when we did not even ask him for it. We wasn't looking for it. We didn't even think we needed it. But God looked past our fault and saw every last one of our needs. Now we have the right to proclaim salvation. Just because God has given us salvation does not mean that he has turned his back on Israel. That's poor theology if you think that God has replaced Israel with the church. That's bad theology. God made Israel jealous by the church. The purpose was to get Israel to jump on the bandwagon. But here's the most beautiful part of the text, and I'm through. Verse number 21, look what God said. But as for Israel, God says, all day long, I have stretched out my hands to a disobedient and obstinate or stubborn people. Take note of the phrase, stretch out my hands. When you and I stretch out our hands or lift up our hands to God, it is a symbol of us trying to connect with God. Similar instance, when God stretches out his hands to us, it is a symbol of God trying to connect himself with us. Despite the fact that God is trying to connect himself with us, we continue to disobey what we know is right to do. The message of salvation gives us instructions. Paints a beautiful picture of God stretching out his hands to us, saying, come unto me, all ye that are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. All you have to do is do what God said do. God has his hands stretched out to us. The heathens now proclaim salvation. You should obey the message of salvation because the heavens proclaim salvation. You should also obey the message of salvation because the heathens proclaim salvation. Matthew chapter 19, verses 16 through 22. The rich young ruler who approached Jesus to ask him how it was he could obtain eternal life walked away from the messenger's message because it required him to change his lifestyle. My question to you, ladies and gentlemen, is, will you too walk away from the messenger's message because you'd rather hold on to your sinful lifestyle? Will you too walk away from the message of salvation because you'd rather hold on to what you have than to receive what you want? May God bless you. May God keep you.